Sean with Voices Live On, and we're doing a little bit of shoe stories with collectors so they can showcase their life as well as what they like to showcase on their feet, buying and selling to the industry. And we got a gentleman today that has been doing it for over 20 years. Billy Bannon, how are you and where are you right now with all those shoes around you?
Hey, Sean, it's great to meet you. I'm in Lawrence, Indiana. And this is what I call the sneaker room. simply put, it could be a closet, but it's literally just a room, Sean, full of sneakers.
All right. So you've been doing this 20 years. You also in college worked at Foot Locker. We're going to kind of dive into this. I'm going to show some different things that kind of represent your life. The very first thing we're going to show is a man that you've looked up to for years, Al Bundy. Is that Al Bundy? Is that the shoe king of sitcom?
I mean, arguably the greatest shoe salesman alive. I don't know his numbers, but, you know, Married with Children did a great job of showing his daily grind.
All right, so I know that you're a big fan of his and probably his daughter Kelly, but let's move on to talk about you and what you've developed. So you've essentially, one, you help manage a Facebook group, and what's the name of the Facebook group?
So Heat for Your Feet, I've had my own Facebook group for the actual, for my actual branding for over 8 years. It just hit 8 years. And this Indiana Sneakerheads is actually a buy-sell trade group that I believe has like 14,000 members. I don't completely know the accuracy of that number, but people come in there, and if they want to sell something, as long as they show up legit and they have pictures and they have kind of proof of authenticity, and I've also got it to where you have to be able to ship. I don't want people meeting up with sketchy people. So I've really had to break this group in order to rebuild it because I did take it over from another admin. But yeah, I've been in charge of that now for, I think, since around the pandemic, maybe 2020, I started doing that. I just had a lot more time on my hands. So yeah, it's been great. I'd be a liar if I told you that the group is as successful as I need it to be, but it is growing. It is definitely growing, and it's only going to continue to grow.
Obviously, it takes a lot of passion, but it takes a lot of research to be able to find the right deals and to be able to, you know, let alone if people are customizing their shoes, you know, so I know that takes a lot of tenacity to be able to really find the ones that make sense and to find the rare ones right when they come out. So if you could just speak to that just for a second of, you know, you do your research, but for the novices out there, what are some of the ways that in process that you really do to make sure you're finding a good deal?
Finding a good deal, if in my personal opinion, is probably going to start on eBay. And if you're looking on eBay, you're going to have a lot of choices to choose from, including my store on eBay. As far as knowing what something's worth, as far as knowing the hype, that there is research, but I have a group called Heat for Your Feet as well, where I post all the new shoes. I give people an idea of what's going to be worth money and kind of what to buy and what not to buy. And it's sad to say the like what not to buy thing, but there are people that are just in this for money and they don't necessarily have a passion. And that's kind of why I started the group because I wanted I wanted it to also be a monetary gain. I wasn't just wanting to involve myself with people that just love sneakers. I wanted to involve myself with people that understood kind of like the betting of buying a sneaker.
Gotcha. All right. So this is your YouTube channel, right? Where you post different shoe clips and whatnot. And then here's a shot of, you know, some of the shoes that you've acquired over the years. The one that you're flipping up the tongue there, what's it say there on the tongue?
What does it say?
Is it a Jordan?
I think it says March 6, 1992. And yeah, that was a commemorative sneaker that they put out as a double package. And believe it or not, most us Jordan aficionados, it was supposed to represent Michael scoring 60 points against Orlando. But if you look up that game, the date is wrong. So Jordan Brand's been known to put the wrong date on stuff. Don't ask me why, but they actually put the wrong date of the day that he scored 60 in that particular sneaker.
All right, so here's a shot, and this is a gentleman that is now passed away. His name is Jonathan Turner. He customized these. You're one of one with your logo on the back heel. The guys who put the time into customizing, are they usually lifers? Like, I know people want to get into it, but they can definitely screw up a pair of shoes and screw up the price of it.
No, usually just like reselling sneakers or buying, selling, and trading sneakers, it's usually their second job. It's usually, if you will, their hustle. Unfortunately, as you know, Sean, we all live kind of in America right now where it's hard not to have a hustle. It's hard not to have a second job. So that was no different for him being a customizer. The cool thing is he was able to use his job, his 9-to-5, if you will, because he used to do, you know, NASCARs and Indy cars. So he used to actually, whatever you want to call it here, not wallpaper. What's the word I'm looking for? Where they lay down the graphics on the car. So
they're just wrapping the car.
Yeah, he used to do wraps. So he was a good person to know. And I came to him originally. I gave him that shoe and it was all gray. And I said, all I want you to do is black it out. And he took it a step further. He put my logo on it. He customized the box that he gave it to me in. And that was a moment. I actually have video of that exact moment. I was working at Grails when he brought them in, and it was just really cool. It was really cool. And him and I had a falling out years ago, and I seen him at a couple shows, but we never really resolved our issues, and that kind of hurts me thinking about it. But at least I have something, you know, that he did.
Yeah, it's great that you have something that to represent him. So here's a shot of one of your first jobs, and it goes kind of hand in hand with the feet at Foot Locker. And this was up in Muncie, is that right?
Yeah, far from one of my first jobs, but definitely the first time I ever sold sneakers in a store, or first time I ever had a chance to work with customers daily in retail. Yeah, so to this day, my current manager that was at that store, I was his assistant. He's still with the Foot Locker company. We're still good friends. And when I can, I try to get over there and buy some shoes from him.
Well, I'm sure that was the beginning of the passion, but also the knowledge of the value. And you know, knowing the values of the shoes. And here's a shot of you at some of your first shoe shows. And who's the gentleman there that you're showing the shoes with in the blue jersey?
Oh, so that's DJ Monte Carlo, and I've known him since 2016 when we both worked at Grails, Grails Inc., I believe, in Washington Square Mall. And to this day, this guy, he's a DJ. So, you know, he does weddings, but he also flies back to Indiana and does almost all the sneaker conventions. that picture you see with him and I, we're literally auctioning off to the crowd the shoe that I have in my hand, which is a Penny Four.
Wow, that's pretty great. And here's some shot of your original merch. I think you got it. I think you got a great logo, and I think it's a good play on words with heat for your feet, which is, you know, great feats that happen in life as far as accomplishments. I think that's really smart play on words. And here's a shot of your first, I guess it was basically your first shoe show that you produced. And where was the shoe show from that flyer?
So that I just attended. I was a person that was selling, but yeah, that was at Fishers High School, which is pretty close to me. And that was the first time I, you know, bought a couple tables and kind of posted up shop and sold shoes. So that was a very memorable moment. I believe that was 2014. I believe 2014, 2015.
And the other picture there with the jerseys, with the brick background, that was at Gary Watson's house. He's a photographer, and he'd help set up shoots for you. Is that right?
Yeah. If you can't tell by the smile on my face, that's one of my favorite things that I've ever done. You know, Gary had the aesthetic, and I just brought the shoes. I mean, that's his house. That's his locker. And I just brought the shoes and hung the jerseys in there. And, you know, he had a number four. I believe that's a Lou Gehrig jersey. If I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's Lou Gehrig. And so, you know, heat for your feet. And we went ahead and put the four there. Those are original Busch Field Indianapolis Indian seats as well. So he's kind of a baseball historian. So with him being a photographer, it just played perfect to what we were trying to do.
All right. That's great. So here's a shot of one of your photo shoots and also the signed Reds hat. You know, who signed the Reds hat and those Jordans there?
Ooh, man. So the Reds hat was at the Reds Caravan in Muncie, Indiana. At one of the car lots, I believe Stoops, I could be wrong. But anyways, this was 2010. Ryan Friel, who is no longer with us on the Reds, signed the hat. Marty Brenneman, who was the voice of the Reds for, I don't know, 30 years, up until a couple years ago, signed the hat. My favorite player that wore number four, Brandon Phillips, Dat Dude BP, a lot of people know him as. And then last but not least, Devin Masarocco, who was kind of the rookie catcher coming up that year that not a lot of people knew about.
Okay. All right. So here's the shot. We're going to kind of skip over to the people that have supported you throughout your life and some people that you've supported. So you as the baby there, the little slugger shot, and you with your with your grandma, Helen, and then your mom, LaVon, is that the proper pronunciation of your mom's name, LaVon?
Yeah, LaVon, like live on.
That's right, like voices live on. So as you started into this shoe game, what was their perception of you getting addicted to the whole industry?
I'm going to be honest, and I think some people don't understand this, but retail can be a drug. It can't. It's just like anything else. I mean, You release endorphins with excitement. You got to be. I kind of hid from. At some point, you get so many shoes, and at some point, you feel like you actually have a problem. And what you're happy about is you're happy that it's not like actually a drug problem. But with my family, with my mom, you know, growing up, I didn't have a lot. So I remember times having, you know, thousands of dollars worth of shoes in the closet and my mom maybe not even being able to pay her bills. You know what I mean? So it was kind of embarrassing. You know, it really was. And I actually mean that. It was kind of embarrassing. My grandma and I never really talked about stuff like that. You know what I mean? It just never completely came up in conversation.
And then as far as later on in life, obviously you've been doing it for a long time, and your mom, is your grandmother still around, or she passed, or?
No, unfortunately, I just talked to my mom. I think texted me a couple of days ago. I think my grandma had just passed, I believe on the 22nd or 23rd a couple years ago. So no, unfortunately, she's no longer here.
Well, somebody else we're going to honor here is your cousin, Sean. I know that he supported you, you know, in your love of shoes. And I know he passed a little while ago, but who's the cat, the cool cat of Rashawn?
So he's actually clawing at the door right now. But that's my cat, Ellie, and he's named after Ellie De La Cruz, who was killing it for the Cincinnati Reds right now. So some friends of mine, well, my buddy Toby, who's also my roommate, we kind of joke that that's Ellie De La Cat.
And here's a shot from way back in the day where you grew up. You know, you said you originally grew up in a trailer and then moved to, where'd you move to, the house, the first house?
So that house is actually before the trailer. Okay. I was in Elwood, Indiana. And then the trailer is Reed Station, Indiana. So yeah, over, you know, it wasn't, you can tell by that picture, you know, I'm not used to having a lot.
Well, you know, you've grown a lot though. And now as we've got there on the slides, you've got over 450 as a collection that you buy and sell. And I want to kind of bring this back to the beginning here. So if you're going to give people advice to be able to work with you personally, just how does that process work, and how can they know for sure you're looking out for their best interest and trying to give them a good deal and do good research on the right shoes for the right price?
Hey, that's a great question, Sean. I, for one, I'm not a person that just tries to sell you anything, and you'll find that out quickly in one conversation with me. You know, I sold cars in the past. I sold data packages at Verizon. So my biggest thing is, what are you looking for? And that's the first question I always ask. What are you looking for? And by that, I mean, what do you really want? Because if you don't really want this product, I'll look for it for you. But I'm trying to uncover who you are. What's your favorite athlete? You know, that plays a big role. What's your favorite athlete? Because you might be looking for something, and I could give you a better sneaker, and you might go, whoa, yeah, I'd rather have those, Billy. And that's kind of like what warms my heart when I find out I've told somebody about something that they didn't plan on buying. Okay. And I was able to find it for them.
And as far as just what we're doing with this format, I know that you see this being a way that other collectors can kind of get their story out there and help connect better and become a little bit more real with their clients that they work with. So what would you like to say to other shoe collectors out there just in general?
Oh, I would say sit down with Sean and do exactly what I'm doing and share your story, because there's a lot of us that need our story heard, and unfortunately it's not happening. You know, there's a lot going on in people's lives, and even me, like when Sean got a hold of me about this, I'm like I'm trying to think of the pictures to come up with and stuff like that. Take pride in it. Take pride in what you've done. Take pride in where you've been. You know, 20 years ago, maybe even 10, 5, I might not have been as comfortable sharing with you where I grew up, the picture of the trailer, the picture of the small house, you know. But as Sean, you know, said, you know, I've come a long way, and I know a lot of you guys have come a long way too. So feel that pride and have an interview with Sean, and it's only going to help. That's all I can say.
Yeah, well, the bigger vision and the bigger purpose is that when people are posting to sell the shoes, that they could also have the linked back or have a link there to their story to just become a little bit more real. And I think that that's something that with all the TikToks out there and all the short little condensed version video formats, that this is a really great way for people to really get to know you. And if they're going to work with you and have you hunt for the shoes of their dreams or just some other shoes they want to add to their collection, you know, it's a way for people to really kind of get to know the real person behind the scenes and behind the boxes. And Billy, I appreciate what you do. I know there's a lot of people out there that might be a novice and might have 10, 12, 15, 20 pair, but you've been dedicated for a long time. And I commend you for your dedication and your knowledge and wanting to pass it on to other people to help them.
Hey, Sean, I appreciate that.
All right. Well, have a good day and just stay in the line. And I'm going to close this one out.
Thanks, Sean.